The Conscript by Honoré de Balzac. On a November evening in the year 1793, the principal citizens of Carentan were assembled in Madame de Day's drawing room. Madame de Day held this reception every night of the week, but an unwanted interest attached to this evening's gathering, owing to certain circumstances which would have passed altogether unnoticed in a great city, though in a small country town they excited the greatest curiosity. For 2 days before, Madame de Day had not been at home to her visitors, and on the previous evening her door had been shut on the ground of indisposition. Two such events at an ordinary time would have produced in Carentan the same sensation that Paris knows on nights when there is no performance at the theatres. Existence is in some sort incomplete. But in those times, when the least indiscretion on the part of an aristocrat might be a matter of life and death, this conduct of Madame de Day's was likely to bring about the most disastrous consequences for her. Her position in Carentan ought to be made clear, if the reader is to appreciate the expression of keen curiosity and cunning fanaticism on the countenances of these Norman citizens, and, what is of most importance, the part that the lady played among them. Many a one during the days of the Revolution had doubtless passed through a crisis as difficult as hers at that moment, and the sympathies of more than one reader will fill in all the coloring of the picture. Madame de Day was the widow of a lieutenant general, a knight of the orders of Saint Michael and of the Holy Ghost. She had left the court when the emigration began, and taken refuge in the neighborhood of Carentan, where she had large estates, hoping that the influence of the Reign of Terror would be but little felt there. Her calculations, based on a thorough knowledge of the district, proved correct. The Revolution made little disturbance in Lower Normandy. Formerly, when Madame de Day had spent any time in the country, her circle of acquaintance had been confined to the noble families of the district. But now, from political motives, she opened her house to the principal citizens and to the revolutionary authorities of the town, endeavoring to touch and gratify their social pride without arousing either hatred or jealousy. Gracious and kindly, possessed of the indescribable charm that wins goodwill without loss of dignity or effort to pay court to any, she had succeeded in gaining universal esteem. The discreet warnings of exquisite tact enabled her to steer a difficult course among the exacting claims of this mixed society without wounding the overweening self-love of parvenu on the one hand or the susceptibilities of her old friends on the other. She was about 38 years of age and still preserved, not the fresh, high-colored beauty of the Basse Normande, but a fragile loveliness of what may be called an aristocratic type. Her figure was lissome and slender, her features delicate and clearly cut. The pale face seemed to light up and live when she spoke, but there was a quiet and devout look in the great dark eyes, for all their graciousness of expression. A look that seemed to say that the springs of her life lay without her own existence. In her early girlhood, she had been married to an elderly and jealous soldier. Her false position in the midst of a gay court had doubtless done something to bring a veil of sadness over a face that must once have been bright with the charms of quick-pulsed life and love. She had been compelled to set constant restraint upon her frank impulses and emotions at an age when a woman feels rather than thinks, and the depths of passion in her heart had never been stirred. In this lay the secret of her greatest charm, a youthfulness of the inmost soul betrayed at times by her face, and a certain tinge of innocent wistfulness in her ideas. She was reserved in her demeanor, but in her bearing and in the tones of her voice there was still something that told of girlish longings directed towards a vague future. Before very long, the least susceptible fell in love with her, and yet stood somewhat in awe of her dignity and high-bred manner. Her great soul, strengthened by the cruel ordeals through which she had passed, seemed to set her too far above the ordinary level, and these men weighed themselves and instinctively felt that they were found wanting. Such a nature demanded an exalt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.